I cannot remember not dreaming about space and spaceflight. I was fascinated by it.
David Saint-Jacques, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Did you always want to be an astronaut?
To say that I wanted to be an astronaut, that would be exaggerating. I never actually thought it was possible. I remember the first times that I saw these images of the Earth seen from space, it just blew my mind. And when I understood that the photographer was standing on the moon, it's like it opened up a whole new area of understanding. And it convinced me that science is cool, and I gotta become a scientist and an explorer, and I just gotta try to understand more and more about this amazing world we live in. So I was working as a family doctor in a remote village when Canada announced that they were recruiting astronauts, and I owe it to a colleague of mine to know about it. She walked into my office singing "Fly Me to the Moon," and I thought, what's wrong here? What's going on? And she told me, you know, David, they're recruiting astronauts. So I think you better apply. And if you don't apply, I'm going to apply on your behalf. When I realized that they were looking for astronauts, you know, it's as if the world stopped for just a few seconds. And I remember that moment still, some shivers down my spine. And I could hear the voice of a little boy in me telling me, oh, David, you got to try. Please try. And I immediately imagine how complicated that would be. The process of selection takes a whole year, and this huge wrench it would throw in my personal life and all that. But I felt like I had almost had no choice. I just have to try. To be an astronaut requires a very specific skill set, and the very carefully try to select people with that skill set, because the main difficulty is that you need to be pretty competent at many, many different fields. You don't need to be the best at anything. You don't need to be an Olympian or a Nobel Prize winner, but you cannot afford to have an astronaut who has any major, you know, problem in a particular area. And I remember one very humbling thing about the selection process. At every step of the way, it was clear to me that there were people in the room better than me at this particular skill, this particular test. And I was always kind of surprised when, after every round, I would be called back again, be called back again. So that realization that I was not the best at any of this stuff, and it was stretching me to my limit every time, and I was worried that I would fail every one of those tests, made me realize that what may be the reason why I got second in the end is just because I didn't fail any of those tests.
What does your training involve these days?
The first year has been mainly, I would say, theory, systems learning. I've been studying, I feel like I could build a serious rocket in my backyard. And now we're getting on to the second phase, more practical training in the simulator with our crew, practicing the procedures, learning not only how should things work normally, but with a great focus on how to react should there be a problem. Practicing continuing training for spacewalks with this puffy white suit that we all know. We have a giant pool in Houston with a full-size replica of space station inside. So we use that to train for spacewalks. Then the Canadian contribution, robotics. So you got to master all of that. Keep your Russian language skills up to scratch.
They've only recently just announced some of the science that you'll be doing on the mission. What are the main science experiments that you've got planned?
So the ISS is an orbiting laboratory. We do research. And so there's thousands of experiments that have been performed since the beginning of station, hundreds going on at any given time. So during my mission, there will be also several hundreds of experiments in various fields, ranging from physics to engineering, material science, and a big focus on medical research. That is Canada's forte. Bulk of our contribution to space station science is in the medical fields and biomedical research and medical technology. So this will be the focus of the Canadian research that I will be doing on board.
You're doing all this during a time where there's an awful lot of rapid change going on in space science in general. How can you situate the current moment in space science? Oh,
yeah. So we're at the crux, you know, of a new era in space flight. And Mars is our Everest. And this is a huge project. And it will require the best of human ingenuity. And it will do the magic that space always does. Because of the harshness of the environment, the extreme challenges, it does seem to spark the best and brightest to scratch their head, and we learn so much along the way, and it all comes back to us. You know, and it will be a big endeavor, and the priority will never be space exploration. It'll always be healthcare, education, economy, employment, security, defense. These are the fundamentals of life on Earth, and we've got to protect that. But we got to keep a small fraction of our energy and resources for blue sky dreaming, for the arts, for science, for exploration, because that is how we progress. That is how we became who we are, by doing the little extra, by scratching our heads, by pushing the boundaries, by broadening our perspective. And space exploration is the step we're at now. And we will do this as an international community, and it will make us, it will just open the door to so many discoveries. I think Mars will be the excuse for an even deeper kind of enlightenment of humanity. It will seal the fact that, yeah, we all have our own national identity, but at the end of the day, we're all humans, we're all Earthlings. This is spacecraft Earth. This is our cradle. This is our only home in the universe. There's no new water, no new air. This is what we got. We've got to be responsible for it. Let's work together.
David Saint-Jacques, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Yes.